We are today with Marcos Xalabarder from Spain. He has been a Prezi expert since around 2010, which is longer than I've been an expert. Congrats, Marcos, that's pretty cool. Marcos has a journalist background and is passionate about multimedia. He's also passionate about visual thinking and especially about writing. He evolved from being a Prezi expert to story angel. He does storytelling mentoring, which comes to the topic that he will develop with us in his masterclass about agile storytelling. He works with major companies more than 10, 15 years, especially in Spain and Europe, but he agreed to share with us some of his knowledge and give us a masterclass on agile storytelling. It's your show, Marcos.
Well, thank you very much. First of all, I'm really glad that you invited me to be part of this conversation. Yes, indeed, I've been Prezi for a long time, but probably you are more expert than me nowadays, because for a long time I've been switching to more than the tool itself into the storytelling techniques. So today, what I'm going to do is try to share the outcome of my evolution as a storyteller, and especially when oriented to helping companies, organizations, or basically anyone to organize their thoughts and in a quick way, try to, you know, communicate them, okay? So I'm going to use a tablet to draw a bit, okay? I'm not a great artist. I'm just, you know, learning how to express myself with drawing.
It's super okay. We love having a peek at your process.
So I'm going to first share my iPad, okay? So what I'm going to tell about today is about agile storytelling, which means how to organize very briefly, very quickly, any ideas you have in order to present them, right? We quickly will move on to Prezi, how to apply that to Prezi, of course, okay? But I think before diving into the tool, which many of your students may know a lot, even a lot better than me, because they probably use them daily, on a daily basis, I think sometimes it's important to just step back and, you know, wrap your thoughts, wrap your mind, because we have deep knowledge of what we want to express, but sometimes we don't find the way. So I'm going to share with you very briefly three structures I use a lot, okay? So the first structure, one, is like the sun. I'm sure you're familiar with this idea. I mean, the sun means that something is central in your mind, okay? Some big idea.
Right. And
you go to smaller ideas that are around or that derivate from that. So what does this look like? This looks like basically a solar system. And I love this metaphor to organize thoughts, okay? Yeah, a solar system is an overview of a system of thoughts, you know, a system of ideas, where there are some bigger ones like the sun, okay, and there are some smaller like the planets, and there are even some even smaller like, for instance, the moon. Now, you organize this in a hierarchic way because you basically want people to understand in one shot what you're going to be talking about, the universe of your thoughts, okay? Any idea is able to be the center of the universe. Sometimes what happens is that you go for the very big idea, and then which you consider the most conceptual of the concepts, and then you make it the center, and then you go making small bits or small parts around it. But you have to try to do the opposite as well. Try to make a very simple thing the center of this universe, and see how everything switches around. You know, for instance, we are talking about literature, okay? Literature. Hmm? And then we say, okay, literature means there are writers, there are readers, blah, blah, blah. And there are tools, like, for instance, a pencil, you know, a pencil, okay. So now let's go back and let's think, okay, I'm going to make the pencil the main character of my story, okay? So I'm going to start by talking about the pen. Okay, so eventually, because it's part of the same system, of the same universe of ideas, I will reach to literature. But I kind of start by telling, you know, the life of a pen, which is going shorter and shorter until it has delivered everything it had to deliver to the world, you know. And at the end of the life of a pen, you have literature. It has become literature, you know. So, why you're laughing?
Because I like the metaphor of the pen giving all it has to give to the world. It's fantastic. Just with the pen, you came out with a great story.
It's an interesting life because instead of growing, it decreases, you know. It's ungrows.
Yes.
It's a backwards life. It comes full of energy, but lives, depleted, you know. So basically saying that having a strong idea doesn't mean that it has to be the biggest one you can imagine, you know. It can be any idea. At the end of the day, the link between the pen and literature that may be in a planet over there, like here, literature, is already set up. It's just the way you want to tell the story, okay? Or you can also start by having as a main character a writer or whoever. So that's a brief introduction to this concept of one, of having one big idea, okay? Now the next one is two, okay? So we have two. What happens when we have two things? What we have is a comparison, is or an opposition. For instance, no? we have water and we have fire, you know? It's a contrast. Gianni Rodari was a wonderful writer and also teacher of literature, and he had this concept of fantastic binomy, which means that every time you compare two different things, there is kind of a reaction, chemical reaction that appears. So basically you can compare a mug with a chair and see what happens with a mug and a chair, or what happens between a table and a chair. They are both furniture, but the table is meant to people to put things on, and the chair is only meant to put bottoms on, you know? So like they have different kind of kind of feelings about their
bottoms or cats.
Bottoms
or cats.
Yes, exactly. So imagine, you know, you are facing a table against a chair. The chair may have some regrets towards the table because the table gets the better part, you know, the food and the conversation, and the chair is always there to serve, but it's below, you know. So you can start imagining a lot of consequences of joining two concepts, you know. What is this useful for? Not only for literature, like I was joking about now. It's about when you have to especially compare two scenarios. Like for instance, an scenario of how are you now, okay? And what do you want to become tomorrow, okay? This is typically when, for instance, a company wants to launch a new project, okay? And you say, okay, this is our departure scenario and this is where we are going, no? So, in this process, there is a transition. There is a bridge, okay? And you can tell a story by only showing two concepts, like one scenario of departure and one scenario of arrival, okay? And the transition in between, okay? This is typically, for instance, this is used in visually thinking when you have like a situation, okay? A challenge, okay? You have seen this many times probably, yeah? There is a bridge,
yeah.
Okay? And here are you, thinking how I'm going to get there where, I don't know, a castle is waiting for me, okay? Okay, and the princess over here. Hello, okay? So, how am I going to cross this? So, here is your purpose, no? Oh, sorry, here's your purpose. Here is your goal, and here is the challenges. Okay?
Right.
So basically you are telling a reader story with those two worlds, you know, because the story is always the transition between two stages, always. So there is always a scenario of departure and a scenario of arrival, and there is a transformation in between, you know. So basically that's a story. Any story can be told like that. So if I had to make a presentation, I have very short time, I could grab one of these quick schemes so people get the idea in one word of where I'm coming from and where do I want to go and what do I have to do to overcome my challenges, you know? Telling the story from one object or one word, telling the story from two objects. Now we get to the interesting part, which is the three, okay? So having three parts is the most natural, in my opinion, way to explain a story, because it starts to deliver progression, okay? Actually, in the previous example, there were three parts, because there is the beginning, there is the bridge, the second part, and there is the end, right? It's just that you put emphasis on comparing both the scenarios, okay, on the contrast. When you have three steps, you have many advantages. Let's see. First of all, it's natural. We all can, you know, summarize our life in three steps. Like, we were born, we grow, we die, right? Or we can choose all the type of events. We were born, we married, and we divorced, for instance. Or we can, you know, in these three events, or I had a child, for instance, that changed my life. So you can always very, very quickly and very briefly deploy a story with only three steps, you know? So there was a conflict. The hero started a journey. The hero defeated the beast. And why it's important to make it in three and not four, five, six, or seven steps, which is obviously possible. Otherwise, movies wouldn't exist. Because it is easy to remember. Structure things in three steps, in ABC. I always do that, always, for anything. If I can summarize things in three blocks, better than anything. Sometimes you can't, sometimes you have to do more, but then try to put them in a category below one of these big steps, you know? Because at the end, the story is start, middle, and end, you know? So the start is a concept, meaning context, the part of situation, what tools do we have, what our expectations are, what are our wishes, etc. This is a big, big planet, you know? Then the middle is all the development, how we start to move, how many tests we have to pass, how many challenges we have to overcome, you know? It's the growth part, is where we grow, we develop. And the end is the outcome, you know, what the result of all these movements. So it's very natural, it's very simple. And if you can, anything you want to talk about, anything you want, and you know, of course, you want to tell this in very structured places, choose three words, choose three actions, three verbs, or three images, and work from there. So let me put an example of this applied to something we all know very well. Probably you know very well this story of Lightie, in English is Red Hood.
Red Hood.
Red Hood, yeah, okay. So let me deploy this story very quickly, okay? We have, on the one hand, one beautiful house, okay, where mom lives, okay? Mom lives. On the opposite of the scenario, we have the house of, it's very similar because I am not a great drawer, okay, but
they're both very good.
Yeah, there are more trees, okay, and there is a river as well, okay, where grandma lives. Okay, I think I can draw grandma. Okay.
That's a great representation.
Okay, so we have one wall on this side. Okay, one wall in this side is this, and one wall at the other side. Okay, what is in the middle? Well, you know, there is a forest, right? There is a forest with plenty of trees and so on. And in the middle of the forest, there is this wolf waiting for a little Red Hood, okay, to come across and find them, okay? So what I want to tell is not this story. It's about the structure, what I'm talking about, okay? So here you have, like, very clearly three parts, you know. The first part is where you speak about, you know, who's Little Red Hood, and then you have all this part of the woods where she transitions, she enters more or less the danger, she enters the adventure, you know, and is tricked by the wolf and so on, and she gets to her mom. Okay, now this is a story everyone knows, and I love to explain this because the structure helps to squeeze or enlarge this story. You could spend more time here, for instance, in this part. Much of the story happens here, you know. Usually you spend very little time on the mom's house, and then you spend a lot of time on the conversation between the wolf and the girl, and then you go to move to the end, you know. But imagine you wanted to really change a bit the story and focus on on the past. I mean, let's say all this part is just the end of the story that begins early, you know? So
right.
We have to invent something here, which is the beginning of the story. Where the mom, where did she grow? Who she married to? Where did she study? Did she study at all or whatever? What's his life? Even the wolf has a past. Maybe he has a group of animals that were with him, and there is a reason why this wolf is so mean and wants to, well, mean, you know, so natural and wants to eat meat, you know? But the thing is that if you think, again, in terms of a structure, then all this part, which is now read, can become the end of the story very quickly, and we can focus on the life of this mom and child, and we can build a new story here, you know? And we can imagine something that is not created, is not in the map. So this means that you can alterate the storyline, or maybe all this story, I'm going to use this tool here, all this story is just the beginning of a new story that is going to be told after this happened, okay? And then appears someone who is from the protection of animals, okay? And starts wondering, where is the wolf? You know, the wolf was protected, you know? And that is a mystery story because the wolf has disappeared somewhere in a well, you know? Now,
right.
Now you have a different story to tell. You have a whole story which has become the chapter one of a new story, you know? So the three acts structure, which is a classical for anything, for theater, for movies, for literature, is very useful to organize very quickly thoughts and events and things and put them under a title, okay?
Right.
So imagine your head is full of knowledge about one, for instance, about Prezi, about mathematics, about anything, okay? This is a big bang of your mind. So what we do as storytellers is organize this in great parts so we can focus and we can move on, you know? You know, I am a journalist. I deal with a lot of information, a lot of many things I don't know about. For instance, then something about real estate or something comes about chemistry or pharma or anything, and I don't know about these issues, but I read and I make great groups and I try to do these three parts, okay? Three great concepts. And then there is a second great advantage, which is progression. A story has to progress. So progression is fundamental because you can divide the world, the universe into three parts, but then it's static, happens nothing. You can see there the star and the sun, the moon and the earth, but you have to move on. If you want to tell something, you have to set up a path, which is very Brazilian, right? You set up a path. It's not new for you guys. So this is what Prezi, I love Prezi because all these things, all this philosophy I am telling about is very Prezi, like Prezi friendly, you know? So you put in movement all this story. But the funny thing here is that why do you need to be in an order? A universe is a universe. Sometimes you will need to explain the story in a different order. So start by the end or what you think is the end and then go to the middle and then go to the beginning. Or sometimes, which is called in media res, you start from the beginning, you go fast to the past, and then you move to the end. So this idea of changing the order is very important. I think is very creative. It's what I call a narrative kung fu. You know, narrative kung fu is the ability of train yourself to tell your story in either way, because you never know who you are going to find or talk to. You never know if this person is actually interested, very much interested in the third point, and you are, you know, boring them, spending one and two.
Right.
So you have to be able to, one, adapt the length of your explanation, you know, the structure, as I said, the structure of the, you have to be able to say, okay, this I'm going to spend 50%, and here 25, and here 25. Or on the other side, we can say, okay, I'm going to really make a long introduction, okay? And then we very quickly go here and very quickly finish here, okay? So you have to be able to do that, and only structure gives you that ability. So this is one thing. And the other thing is the order you tell the story. So I invite you to train yourselves to say, okay, I used to explain the story from A to B and then to C. Let's try it from C to A and from A to B. Train that, because the more you train, the more flexible you are to tell the story. And beyond that, you will start getting new insights about your own story. Like maybe you have to make questions that you haven't thought about, but maybe your customer or your audience is going to, you know? So that's the idea of difference of a linear storytelling and a, how can you say, a conversational storytelling, where you can start from any point, okay? I'm going to put then an example about this in Prezi, okay? Prezi delivers you with a huge canvas, like a whiteboard, okay? So,
right.
Limits on organizing. And the second thing is a very, very clever mechanism of zooming in and zooming out, which goes perfectly in tune with what I'm telling you about, you know? So if I have to talk to you about storytelling, I can summarize this in three words. These are my three keywords. I mean, anyone else can use other keywords, okay? But I can say, look, storytelling is about people, it's about emotions, and it's about technique. Okay, why is it about people? It's because it's about you, it's about me. Every one of us is living a story that is worth to be told. You may have had a very long period of sadness, let's say, okay? You have a long period of sadness, and then your life is sadness. No, that can be the beginning or the previous stage of a story that is now starting to develop in another direction. The thing is how time squeezes and enlarges depending on how we attach emotions to it, to them, you know, how attached we are to those emotions. So sort of storytelling is part of a story living, you know, story living, how you live your story, you know. So it's about people because we all can relate to a story. We all can relate to a story. You know, stories come from the very early ages where people would transfer knowledge to each other by word, you know, by talking, by picturing how could you overcome a situation. Stories are familiar to us, and it's because it's all about people, because there is no other being in this planet that is moved by stories, only people, you know?
Right.
So if in a way, when you are using storytelling techniques to communicate, you are going to touch something, some fiber in the other person, because it's going to be related to that. If you only use data or you only use like examples or very of facts, there is no progression, there is no challenge, there is nothing you can relate to. So it's going to be not emotional, kind to be intellectual, but not emotional. And some studies show that you remember more something that has created an emotion in you, you know, than mere facts or mere figures, you know? So when I go back from this concept, people, now people is for you not only a word, like a mainstream word, people means, you know, so many things. Now people is attached to what I have explained to you about it, you know? It's a little bit attached to my own experience, which I have shared. It's a little bit attached to my view of the world, which I have shared, or for what I have defined people to be. Now, people there is not just a word, it's a little planet with a certain shape I have given, okay? And you will remember right. That for a while. You have redefined the word in this. Now, I say, okay, this is people, but there is not enough with people. There needs to be emotions, okay? I am progressing. I am adding a new step, which is I have the people, the person, but now I have to put in the heart, you know, the living part. So I focus on emotions. Why is storytelling so important for emotions? Because the brain generates different kind of chemicals when listening a good story. Oxytocin is about alert, is about when you have to be aware or awaken about something. So for instance, I'm telling you a story that has like a thriller, you know, there was a situation of danger, the dog was about to attack me. Well, there is kind of alertness in the listener. But anyway, these things generate some kind of emotions. And emotions are information, are heavy information happening to you, not just going through your brain like so much words and things, but happening. You are experiencing them. So
right.
A story ignites emotions, ignites experiences, okay? And mm-hmm. all engagement when you feel something, it leads to action. You want to save that person, that you heard this story about someone who was hanging from a cliff, and you're like, oh, if I was there, I start imagining I could throw a rope, or I could help, or how would I feel hanging from there, you know? So it leads to action, it moves action, because we can identify to them, you know? Even if you go to the movies to see a Batman or a Spider-Man movie, you get out of cinema wanting to be that character. Remember Matrix, the effect Matrix goes to you? We were out of the cinema, we came out of the cinema. And we all were thinking, where is the
what is this real?
And it lasts until today. Imagine this is like a Cosmovision that it lasts today, because you know, yes, there is a matrix, someone is programming us and whatever, and blah blah blah, blah, you know. Okay, we have zoomed out now, and again, emotions is not just any emotion, it's emotions related to storytelling, it's emotions more related to what I have told you. So this is the simplest way to approach, but what I have colored the words, because people is now more related to something like a biological person. Emotions is red, is about, red is emotional color. And then technique, which is a blue, like a blueprint color, right? And then I have said, okay, we have people, we have emotions, and then we need technique, because people and emotions alone don't make a story. Don't make a good story. I mean, right. every world, all in the world is full about people and emotions, but most of them cannot tell a good story. What do you need? Techniques, tools. That's where you go into, and you need a kind of knowledge of how to structure them, how to put the climax, how to start a story, how to end it, you know? So idea, structure, and style really shape what the story is about, okay? So as I said, stories needs progress, and in order to make a progress, you need to put things in certain moments of the line, you know, to make this transformation right. happen and be reasonable. If I have like 3 minutes and I cannot even draw anything, I just have to explain something. Okay, my choice would be choose three good words and make them progress and make them and start looking at them as if they were the parts of a whole story, because I could tell the story beginning from the technique. I could make the technique the most important part. I could say there is no story without technique. That could be my title. There is no story without a structure. Okay. Oh, but yes, there are people who tell their stories and they are using structures. They know it, or they know if they are good at it, you know? So the next thing right. is empty technique serves no purpose. You need what? Emotions. That's the gasoline of technique. You know, you need to pour this gasoline in the car so it works, you know? And finally, mm-hmm. someone has to drive it. Who? The people.
Right.
Because the story starts and ends with people, you know? So you right. see, start being creative in the way you tell the same story by just changing the order of the parts you have chosen to make, you know, to make the story, you know? Or I could start the emotions and be very, very passionate about it and tell you, look, there is no storytelling without the heart, without emotion. Emotion is the only thing that really matters. And then you need, okay, then you can start saying, okay, I go with now with the technique, making it the bridge to reach to the people, or I can go with the people, making it the bridge to reach to my final point, which is the technique. The technique is the outcome, because you can have the best story, you have the best audience, but you need to plant it like in ground. If you don't plant it, it will vanish, you know? And the technique is
right.
So I think you also realize that I'm using a lot of metaphors, which are very helpful. Metaphors, images you may have to compare. So these are not longer three single words from a dictionary. these are filled with a certain purpose, a certain use, you know? And very quickly moving on to the next one is, okay, now let's not be so boring and let's just start using images, okay? I think here is the idea is very Prezi, again, very Prezi, like, is that you choose like three icons, three images, three concepts, and you don't even need to tighten them because you are going to explain them. And when people understand what you're talking about, they are going to memorize very quickly all these three images. They are going to remember. So again, I can go in and explain the same story than before, but at the end of the day, these three icons here substitute, replace what I was using as words. And you can easily memorize them. And still the story is not empty. The story, I'm going to fill the story. It's like a glass, an empty glass. I'm filling
it. Right.
Okay, my last approach, and to finalize this, probably I have taken too much of your time, but my last approach is that...
I thank you for your time. We all thank you for your time.
I'm very glad, really, to be here. Very glad. It also helped me to develop myself. So my final thought is that if you can use your own drawings, then it's going to be a very emotional presentation. It's even going to engage more. So you see, you don't need to be Picasso here. You can just, you know, I'm going to talk to you about storytelling. For me, it starts about people, emotions, and structure. You see, these are very simple drawings, mm-hmm. any child can do. And they give you the ability to do them fast, very quickly, and incorporate them. You can do it by paper. I do it with the tablet. It's easier, but you know. And then you go about the structure, and you can start using even the image, like I was telling you, know, okay, it doesn't matter if you start with the middle or you go to the start. Train yourself to tell the story all the ways you can, all the ways, because it's in you.
Right.
And we are the storytellers. We are the pathfinders, you know? So if you do that, you will start to get insights you never thought you would get just because the order you have chosen to tell your story, you know? And
right.
If you go to emotions, you see I have put these three words because one thing to develop further is, okay, I have gone into the emotions. Now let's divide this into three more concepts, okay? What is emotions about? Well, for me, it's a brain activation because they are like chemical happening over there. There is the emotional part of the feelings and how we feel, the experience we get. And there is another thing that I can add to the subject, which is transportation, which is the ability we have to see, to put in other people's shoes, you know? Is when
right.
I am telling you something that may have happened to you, maybe not exactly, but similar. You are I am transporting you to my story. And we are basically living in the same world. So when you go out, you remember your own story compared to mine, and that is going to make kind of engagement together, you know? These are only a few examples, you know? So I could tell a story only with these three drawings. Mm-hmm. I can tell it because I know it well. I can speak about this 2 hours, 3 hours. I mean, no, I have enough information to fill the time.
Right.
But I have chosen this only for this particular masterclass, these three words. Maybe in a different class, I choose other three different words or different concepts that will shape my story, you know? So to finalize this, I'm going to tell you what. I started being a person, okay, with an empty path ahead of me, you know? And because I live so many emotions like anyone else, I live experiences, good and bad, some very bad experiences that let me down, that put me down, that pushed me to the level of, you know, of learning how to love myself, you know, and put myself in the world, you know. Then I could finally get to a shape, a structure, a way to express who I was, how I relate to the world, and this is my structure. So my life is actually like this image, you know. I start like anyone else. I get my share of emotions, my share of experiences. And finally, I find what is my best path, the best way I can help the world. I can help myself. I can help others to develop. I find my job, my proper way of doing things, you know? So this is one of the thousands of ways I could tell you about the storytelling, about my life, or about almost anything. I will finalize totally just recommending people to do this little exercise, okay? You basically choose three objects in your house, any three objects you find, a glass of water, a pipe, for instance, and a match, for instance.
A match.
So you have three objects, okay? And you have to make them become your story, any story. Mm-hmm. So tell me, Pablo, something you would like to talk about, for instance, anything. Like, you like soccer, for instance, or something?
Well, I was born in Argentina, so okay. I used to like soccer, though I haven't been exposed to soccer for so many years.
Let's say you want to talk about Argentina. I am very interested. You tell me about Argentina, okay? Now, now you have to only choose like three keywords to tell me about Argentina. Which would they be?
Would be mate, which is a beverage similar to coffee or tea that we drink in Argentina. I would choose soccer because it's so ubiquitous, like soccer is so. I would choose also asado. Asado is asado. Asado is a way of cooking meat that is very popular in Argentina, which is delicious, but the main point of it is that people gather all together to eat asado because it takes some time. So we have a chat and a glass of wine while cooking the meat. And some of us are making salad, some of us are making the meat, some others are playing with the kids, and then we gather all together around the table to have a good meal.
Don't you notice that you have chosen three things that are made in common, like in society? They are all celebrated together, football, asado, and mate, which is also shared. It's very important to share.
Yes.
So you think, okay.
No. We're in the middle of a pandemic, so mate is an individual thing, at least for a couple of years.
But Pablo, then you are touching a very important point, is how do we miss these things, you know? How important is to be a society? How important is to share these ceremonies that we are not able to do now? But it's very important that you start building a story about talking about Argentina. You talk about the past, how it was. You are referring to the present. Now we can't. We are willing to do this again, probably better than before. Probably in another mood, because, you know, football, we used to argue, we used to fight. But if we could again celebrate football, wouldn't we try to make it nicer, make it wiser, you know? If we were again to share mate, wouldn't we be more gentle, possibly, instead of, you know, trying to make the first sip and then...
Well, I'm pretty sure that after the pandemic, we will all value those little things much more.
So no,
like being able to share a moment with other people, it's going to be very appreciated.
I tell you that basically you are building a story. You are telling a story which is touching because it's about something we used to do in the past, something we can do now, and something we wish we could do. That's a story. It's a progression. And in this progression, we expect some transformation, something that we expect this to be better than it was because of the struggle we had to go through, you know? And now to finalize, I tell you, this is mate, okay? This represents mate, okay? And it's going to be like water. Matter is like water. It's basically water and air.
It's like coffee. Matter is like coffee.
Yeah, but but you put water in it, right? So
yeah.
So at the end of the day, what water?
This is matter. This is matter. Let's show to the audience. This is German matter, and I have a thermos with hot water. This is like tea or coffee, but it's an herb called matter, and you pour.
This is fantastic, Pablo. It's fantastic. I'd like to share
you
that.
Pour, you pour it and you drink it.
But now, Pablo, let me tell you this. You have used a literal picture of matter, right? Now I am forcing you to imagine this represents matter. So what other are there that are related to matter? For instance, transparency, life. This water is life. Is important to life. What else is something we all need? Matter is not a life-saving thing, probably, but we can say there is a value in matter because in Uruguay, in Argentina, you drink it a lot. It's like water, So you may find in the symbol of water of this glass something that relates to matter and adds some value to the literal image of matter. Second thing, the match. It can be football, because it can either be the potential to ignite something like a fire, or it can be a rage, It can be many things. It can be light a fire to warm ourselves, or it can destroy, It can be a
game. Right, yeah. It can go either way.
The match, because I am forcing to relate the match to football, I am getting new insights. I am getting new ideas of what this can mean, about football. And still I am...
That's so an interesting concept about how to work and help people to develop a story. It's amazing.
And not the least, the pipe is very similar to the third concept, because we said asado, okay, you have
asado,
to...
Asado, yes.
Was it's tobacco is not meat, but this also represents in the ancient cultures of American Indians represents the peace, something you share, moments of sharing, moments of sharing with the world, the wisdom. Mm-hmm. And asado is a ceremony, it's a religious ceremony in Argentina, because people gather
pretty much
and very wise about the meat, they know everything about the meat, and they know everything, and they gather together. So this is a gathering symbol. You may have never made the relationship between a pipe and asado, but once you are forced to do that, you get new insights or new relationships or new feelings about the concept of asado. This is not only about frying meat. It's about something.
A lot more. And we can find, and you can find more and more acts. You do that exercise that you are teaching us.
This random choose of images or icons and forcing yourself to make a match between the icon or the symbol or the image and the concept you want to talk about will ignite new ideas that will enrich your imagination. And why is that? Because everything in this world is related. Everything. It sounds like a network of meanings that are related and connected, like the neurons. And therefore, you are able to tell the stories with very simple things as much as you want, in any order you want, anytime you want. And that's what I call Kung Fu Narrativo, Narrative Kung Fu.
It is amazing. It is amazing, amazing concept. I like very much how you actually deliver the full masterclass based on three words. You started with three words and using that... going through those three words in different contexts and representing them in different ways. You spoke about them again and again while teaching new ideas and new techniques, which is exactly what you have been teaching. The whole development of the masterclass, it's amazing because you use you implement what you are teaching to deliver the masterclass. This is amazing.
Well, Pablo, I'm really glad because this gives me the opportunity to do this, to learn and to find this and to make sure that, how do you say, that I can do this as well. Because if I can, anyone can, We haven't agreed on the objects or anything, but we have just made the exercise to relate things and think about it, and we can do it anytime,
It's amazing. I have one more question. Would you be available for answering questions if my students have questions for you?
Yeah, sure. If I can answer them, yes, sure.
So, Marcos, thank you very much for investing this time with me and all our students. This has been amazing. And again, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Pablo, for what you are doing, and keep it up.